he told it his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. So evidently there was some animosity there that increased as Joseph revealed that he had this gift of dreaming. And then we go into verse 6, and he said unto them, "Hear, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose and stood upright. And behold, yours stood round about and made obedience to them." In other words, it bowed down to them. His brethren said to him, "Should thou indeed reign over us, or should thou indeed have dominion over us?" And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. He dreamed yet another dream and told it his brethren, and said, "Behold, I have dreamed a dream more, and behold, the sun and the moon, even the stars, made obedience to me." And he said it to his father and his brethren, and his father rebuked him, and said unto him, "What is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Should I and my mother and my brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee, to the earth?" And his brethren envied him, and his father observed the saying. So his father wondered about the saying. Back in the Old Testament, we understand people got received things from the Lord through, not like we do today. Today we do it through what we call intuition. You can call it the spirit. You say something made me want to, I should, something told me. That's your intuition, your subconscious. It's just like a field, a fertile field, your subconscious. Whatever you throw in it, it's going to come up. So good or bad. So that's why you have to feed your subconscious, yourself, good stuff. Because that's what's going to spring up. And God comes to us even today in dreams, and he'll plant something in us while we're dreaming. That's the most, we're very susceptible while we're sleeping. Our mental man, our physical man, everything is at rest except for the subconscious. He's never sleeping. He's always looking for something to receive. So you can receive it in your subconscious while you're in the shower, driving the car, doing anything. Something can come into your subconscious, good or bad, and if you allow it in, it's going to grow. Whatever is targeted there. So the Bible tells us, guard yourself out of that. We all know that. So let the good stuff in. A lot of times when we're sleeping, we're vulnerable, and God knows it. I'm going to send him something. I'm going to tell him what I've been trying to tell him right now. And Joseph dreamed the dream. It's in the Old Testament. In the old ways, that's how they did it. New Testament, we do it that way. Also through the Holy Ghost. Talk to your self-conscious, your unconscious, and what we call intuition. Talks to it, and it receives it, and so on. But so Joseph, back in that day, he dreamed, and it happened. His father knew that there must be something up here. I got to watch what this boy is doing. Young boy, youngest of his sons. He dreams and he'll boast about it. That's going to be your downfall, son. You should keep it quiet. That's what his father's trying to tell you. Keep it to yourself. No, he told his brother, and his brother hated him more. Now, so that's his problem. He's a dreamer. Now, that's good. If you're a dreamer, you're receiving something in your subconscious. This lesson is teaching us from very kinds of angles. Once you do dream something, God puts something into your subconscious. The next thing you want to do is come up with a plan. Genesis 41:38. Hope I'm not skipping too fast. But whatever the Lord plants into your subconscious and is good, and you want to see it come alive, the best thing for you to do is come up with a plan. To make it happen. Look, that pretty girl God showed you, you're not married. You call her. Can you read what your Bible says in verse 38? Verse 38. Is there anybody so unique like this person who has the Spirit of God on them, in them, working in them? Obvious. This is obvious about him. He's dreaming, he's receiving, he can tell you what God's plan is. Is there anybody like this man? Anybody else like this man? So we're going to go on a bit further. and we're going to see. All right, so let's go into our first verse. Let's see what we can get out of here. And the thing was, let's go to chapter 41. We got some problems developing. And chapter 40, let's go into chapter 40. We're going to go through that real quick, fast. What we see is Pharaoh's upset because Pharaoh's have this things going on. And Pharaoh says in verse 2, chapter 40, Pharaoh was mad against two of his officers, against the chief of the butlers, against the chief of the bakers. He put them in a ward in the house of the captain of the guard, into the prison, the place where Joseph was bound. And the captain of the guard charged Joseph with them, and he served them, and they continued a season in the ward. I think that's a year, if I'm not mistaken. And they dreamed, both of them, each man his dream in one night. Each man according to the interpretation of his dream, the butler and the baker of the king of Egypt, which were bound in prison. Joseph came unto them in the morning, looked upon them, and behold, they were sad. And he asked Pharaoh's officers that were with him in the ward of his Lord's house, saying, wherefore look ye so bad? And they said unto him, we dreamed a dream. There is no interpreter. Joseph said unto them, do not interpret, the interpretations belong to the Lord. Tell me, I pray you. And the chief butler told his dream to Joseph and said to him, in my dream, a vine was before me. And verse 11, jump down there. Pharaoh's cup was in my hand. I took the grapes and pressed them into Pharaoh's cup. And I gave the cup into Pharaoh's hand. Joseph said to him, this is the interpretation. The three branches are 3 days. Within 3 days shall Pharaoh lift up thine hand and restore thee to thy place. And thou shalt deliver Pharaoh's cup to his hand in the former manner when thou hast. So what has happened is butlers in jail. Butlers getting out of jail. The Lord is showing you that the Lord is showing you that you're going to be released from jail. Boom. That's what's been happening. And somewhere Joseph asked the butler to remember me when you go back in front of Pharaoh as your good prison buddy. Tell him I'm, you know, put in a good word for me. All right, so, and that's going to be somewhere, look at verse 21. 14. What is it, 15?
14.
Think of me when it shall be well with thee, and show kindness, I pray thee, unto me, and make mention of me unto Pharaoh, and bring me out of this house. Make mention, put in a good word. So, as we know, the butler did what? He forgot, according to verse 22 and 23. And it did, did not the chief butler remember Joseph, but he forgot him. How many would be like that cold? Just forgot. Okay. Now, it took 2 full years for things to start turning around in Joseph's life. The key there was that's telling us is that it may not happen so fast. But God gives you something in your subconscious, your inner man, your intuition. You feel it. It's real. I think this is good for us. It may not mean that it's going to happen next week. But it took 2 years between chapter 41 and the end of chapter 40. And it came to pass at the end of 2 full years that Pharaoh dreamed, and behold, stood by the river. So things are starting to happen here. And the problem we say that the dream is showing Pharaoh something. Verse 14, Pharaoh sent and called Joseph, and they brought him hastily out of the dungeon, shaved him, and he shaved himself, and changed his garments, and came into Pharaoh. Pharaoh said unto Joseph, I have dreamed a dream, and there is none that can interpret it. And I have said of thee, I have heard said of thee, that thou canst understand a dream to interpret it. Joseph answers Pharaoh, it is not in me. God should give Pharaoh the answer, an answer of peace. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, in my dream, he's telling him what he dreamed. That came up, verse 18, out of the river, 7 kine, flat fresh and well favored, and fed in the meadow. In the meadow, 7 other came up, poor, very ill favored. such as I have never saw in all the land of Egypt. Verse 20, and the lean and the ill-favored kind did eat up the first ox. What is this I'm seeing? What is this I'm seeing? Verse 28, this is the thing which I have spoken unto you, what God is about to do, he showed unto Pharaoh. In other words, God is getting ready to do what? Create an economic hardship. Chief ingredient, starvation. Better known as no food, famine in the land. Very serious when you have your whole national economy go down the tank. Your whole national enterprise go down the tank. And that's what a lot of the political arguments are about today, is that our national financial well-being data is pointing in the wrong direction. So, it's going to cause the leadership some concern. This is what it's causing here. And then we jump into our verse 37. Let's see what we got in verse 32. For that the dream was doubled in Pharaoh twice, it is because the thing is established by God, and God should shortly bring it to pass. So this is how God is dealing with Pharaoh, showing him the dream over again. Now therefore, let Pharaoh look out men. This is Joseph telling him what to do. Look out men, discreet and wise, and set him over the land of Egypt. Let Pharaoh do this. Let him appoint officers over the land. Take up the fifth part of the land of Egypt in the seven plenteous years. And let them gather all the food of those good years. Come lay up corn under the hand of Pharaoh. And let them keep food in the cities. And that food should be for storage to the land against the 7 years. In other words, make plenty in abundance. The good years that you have, you're making a lot of dollars, don't spend the whole dollar. Key. I just told you. Somebody ought to offer me coffee and donuts this morning. When you make a dollar, don't spend the whole dollar. Put some of that, the portion of that dollar back for some years and forget about it. Prosperity 101. Okay, verse 38. And Pharaoh said unto his servants, can we find such a one as this is a man in whom the Spirit of the Lord is, who has this kind of divine wisdom? Can we find one? And then we're going to go into verse 37, starting with our lesson. Verse 38. Can someone read verse 37 and 38?
And the thing was good in the eyes of Pharaoh and in the eyes of all of his servants. And Pharaoh said unto his servants, can we find such a one as this is, a man in whom the Spirit of God is?
Okay. Pharaoh said unto Joseph, for as much as God has showed thee all this, there is none so discreet and wise as thou. I don't find nobody around here in the hood that can bring us out and straighten up this ghetto. There is one in the ghetto that can make a difference. Do you know anybody? I asked the class today, in your community, and you know how many live in the ghetto? You know anybody that can make an economic difference? We ought to be listening. Locally, statewide, nationally, that can get us out of this mess. Y'all scared? Y'all ought to be offering me coffee. Well, Pharaoh says, oh, I look like we found one whom God can talk to, a believer in God. Obvious. Everybody knows it. Look at his life. You know, turned down my wife. You know, he could have had her. No one else. But he has, he's got morals, integrity, and stuff about him. Don't we know one? Locally, statewide, nationally? That the Spirit of the Lord is talking to some man that can get us out of this mess. that's coming upon us.
Ooh.
What do you say, Brother Ron? Is somebody praying? Somebody getting up, going to church, listening to God? All right. Verse 39 again. Pharaoh said unto Joseph, "For as much as God has showed thee all this, there is none so discreet and wise as thou art. Thou should be over my what?
My house.
So what was the, you're going into the interview, Joseph raises me in the interview. What is it that you want the HR person, Sister Deborah, to see about you? Want me to be able to discern about you? I'm giving you a job here in the Treasury Department of PSO. You want to be the chief financial officer. You want to be the bank depositor. You want to be the timekeeper. What are you looking for, Sister Deborah? Somebody that can count from 1 to 10? Or somebody that's got something else about them?
Something else.
Something else.
It's a previous experience. What have you done?
Okay. Got a track record. If I look at it, what would it what? Show me.
You know what you're talking about.
How about honesty, integrity? When you look into something like that, is it lawful to see if this guy's a felony? Does he hold up widows, quick trips, and do gas runoffs and things like that? You know?
Bernie Madoff can't apply.
You hire a contractor for your house. Do you just want his skills, or do you want to know, can I leave the house with you here?
Yeah.
Is that right, Brother Curtis? They leave the house sometimes when you do it? Yeah. Leave the house, jewelry, Rolex, rocks on them, you know, jewelry, hanging around, silver and all that. Do I have to shake you down before you leave? You say you're a Christian and all this. Can I discern that about you? And this is what Pharaoh is saying to Joseph, is that I can tell. So here's what I'm going to do. We got a problem coming up. We're going into starvation. Famine's coming up. And based upon what you told me about my dream, I believe what you were telling me, based upon not your intellect, but it's something about you that I can detect that you got, that something is going on. You not only deal with man, but you have a relationship with the Almighty, the invisible. So I'm going to hire you. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to have my boy over here watch you all the time. That's not what happened. I'm going to hire you, and it's, you got the run. Let's see what he says here. Verse 40. Thou should be over my what? House, and according to my word should all my people be ruled. Only in the throne will I be greater than thou. There was another man who had such an assignment. I wonder who we could figure out who he was. There was another man that had such an assignment. You got it going on. Turning it all over to you. I'm the only one above you. Sister Pearl, got a clue? Anybody? He's listed in this particular book. Mm-hmm. Well, I got a family in church that reads the book of Genesis. His name was Adam. Turning it all over to you. Whatever shot you call, that's the way it is. I ain't even gonna be watching you back. Sending somebody to watch over. You got it. You the man. You run the show. Turning it all over to you. This big old earth that I created is all. Everything got to bow to you. day you got saved, that's what the Lord whispered into your subconscious. It's all yours. Everything out about you. I got Timothy's old. Comments. So it has happened before. I'm turning it all over to you. You hear what the Lord is saying. So whatever he's telling you to do, you do it because you're in charge. You don't want it. You don't want it. Everything bows to you. Sickness, poverty, disease, everything. You see all that stuff. It's real. It's out there. But you got a plan how to be. Not only for yourself, but for anybody else. Oh, hallelujah. Hope that was a blessing. It should at least deserve a cup of coffee. Thou shalt be over my house, and according to my word, according to my word, according to, based on my authority, be you rule. Verse 41. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, See, I have set thee over how much of Egypt? All the land of Egypt. Ever heard that say to a man before? His name was Adam. That's right. That's right. Look here, Adam. Look here. It's all yours. That's why, come on, saints. We're gonna tell you, look how you gotta look at your salvation. Look at it. It's all yours. Not just a piece of it, some of it. Can't go on that side of the tracks or this side of this neighborhood, that neighborhood. It's all yours. We're not giving you all things. Ooh, brother, we just can buy that.
It's like a name on
this. Yeah, this name. It really is. But what you got to have next is what? A plan. I wish I'd have heard this when I was this guy's age. I'll be a multi-billionaire today. I got everything. I'll set a plan for everything. I ain't here until I got a plan. When I set a plan, I got a plan. All right. And Pharaoh took off, so I'm gonna read verse 42.
Pharaoh took off his ring from his hand and put it upon Joseph's hand and arrayed him in vestures of fine linen and put a gold chain about his neck.
So not only am I telling you, but I'm going to show to everybody else who's in charge. Verse 43. He made them do what? In the high place. I think there's a scripture in maybe the book of Ephesians that has made us to sit where? Made you sit. Here's your seat. Whoa! Took me out of that old buggity buggity ride. Put me in a boss ride. We don't read the story like that, but that's exactly what's happening. Took you out of that dungeon of a prison, cleaned you up, and put you in a boss ride. I've been showing it to you through dreams. I've been telling it to you. I knew you could receive it, just giving it to you. You believed it. You know you got that kind of stuff in you. God talks to you during your dreams. I knew I should. Yes, I told me. Man, what's going on? It's your subconscious spirit, your spirit alive to God, trying to give to you what God wants you to have. And then you step out the door and look at the neighbor and say, I had a bad dream. What was all that? How'd that get in my head? What was all that? And just throw it all away. And don't set a plan. Don't set a plan. It's important. That's 99% of our problems today is that we don't plan. We didn't plan. Don't plan to get it. Look at them, that's all yours. You can't do all this in one day. You can't name everything. Put a name to everything in one day. You can't travel the whole earth in one day, but you ought to plan some what? Travel time. So you can see all this stuff. Okay. All right. So God says, not only I'm telling it to you, I'm going to show. So God is showing in verse 42. Verse 43, what is he doing? What did he say there? Okay, read it to me.
And he made him to ride in the second chariot which he had, and they cried before him, bow the knee, and he made him ruler of all the land of Egypt.
He made everything bow to him. Everything and everybody. Gave him something. Now, have we been given anything, New Testament folks, that all opposition has to bow to? Hallelujah. There you go, walking around here, it's all yours, and you got stuff come up in the way, and you say, man, you get up and give a testimony, boy, I got beat up by the devil all the way along here. Oh, man, can y'all pray for me? And, oh, bring me a tanker chief, something like that. Oh, it's just bad out here. I wish the Lord would hear me and answer my prayer. Help me out, Brother Curtis. What do we need to do? Got the name. God has given you what?
The name of Jesus.
The name of Jesus. Everything got a bow if you use that name and that authority behind it.
Amen.
That's what he told Joseph. See, I'm giving you my authority and everything here. And everything. Let it be bound to you. And when Joseph came around, they just bowed. When you say, mean from one day to the next day, it's like that? Yes. Lost one day, found the next. Lost one day, saved the next. No power one day, got all power the next day. That's what Jesus said. Look, all power, I got it. Look. Behold, now here it is, you got it. Go and go. You got all this. That's what made me excited about my salvation. I didn't want to get saved at 23, 25, have to wait 100 years to die and go to heaven. That's too much fun still out here. And God told me, you can have all that fun, and you can have it all clean, and you got all this authority, and it's all yours. Oh, it's all what? Yeah, wow. Salvation stuff's good. How often should I get sick? God says you don't get sick. You make sickness bow to you. You make poverty bow to you. You make everything bow to you. Use my name. I got excited. 37 years ago. Well, what about everybody else? They're not using my name. They're not using my thought. That's the difference. They're not bold enough to use my thought. Oh, so it's in Genesis. Okay. So he's got it. He's ruling. That's who we are. That's what he has done for us. It has happened before. Gave that kind of authority to a man named Adam. Adam lost it. Another man named Jesus came and regained it and gave it back to us. Boom. All right. That's how we can parallel this lesson to us today. Now let's go further. Someone read verse 44, if you will, please.
And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, I am Pharaoh, and without thee shall no man lift up his hand or foot in all the land of Egypt.
Man, that's tough. Boy, I just got out of the pen. just got out. I'm you, the man. Lift up, so I just got out of hell. We just got saved. Now, then the next day, look, this is what you can do. Everything's going to be bowing to you. Now, you got to be a tough ruler. This, now, how many think Joseph was a passive ruler? Easy going, well, they didn't listen to me, that's all right.
No.
I bet he done his job. We got some serious issues coming up. 7 years from here, from today, there will be no food growing. I'm the type of guy who likes to eat. So riding my ride here. So, so you're going to be doing what I tell you to do. And if you're not, guess what? You just go. You dig? I'm going to have time for you. Because we're talking about everybody likes to eat, and I got to feed the whole land, and I'm going to be riding and looking good and eating. Y'all coming with me? Or are you just going to be dead? I ain't putting up with nothing. That's the attitude.
This is true.
So you got to have a mental attitude that this is what the Lord says, and we ain't going, this is what he told me to do. You're going to do it riding with me, or if you ain't riding with me, you're getting out of the way. We let them unsaved relatives just hang around and influence the crowd. Unsaved co-workers and everybody else just influence the whole scene because we don't take what authority.
Give a little testimony.
Okay.
I just had an uncle pass with cancer Friday,
mm-hmm.
and when he was very sick and close to passing, I asked my auntie, I said, well, have he received Christ as a Savior and stuff, talking about it or what? And she said, no, he have not. She said, when anyone tries to talk to him about it, my mom, daddy, anybody, he just totally changed the subject.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, okay, then. I said, well, and I thought to myself, well, ain't no sense me saying that. He ain't going to listen to me. But anyway, what I did is I prayed to God, and I prayed that God would take that spirit of rebellion away and open his heart up to receive Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got in prayer with my cousin that's a minister in California, and we prayed for his heart to be unhardened and everything else. And before he left here, he did confess because he was in so much pain, he had to cry out to God,
mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm,
with the cancer and everything.
Mm-hmm,
and so
mm-hmm.
when she told me, his wife told me that he accepted Christ, about tears to my eyes because
okay,
I was satisfied and happy.
Praise God.
Yeah.
You go in there and you just deal with the tradition and the protocol that's already set up, you know, some work for some hospitals got priests and stuff on the way. And wait a minute, now who's taking authority? I went into a room, the person was on the machine, oxygen on it. They getting ready to let him go. The mourning crowd, the crying crowd is
mm-hmm.
here. You know, I'm going, hey, y'all get out of here. That's what I go, no, get out. What? Get out. Then I pray. Then the person recovered. So you can have people come to a hospital room or situation that's
mm-hmm.
just going through the emotions.
Yeah.
And then you just put up with that and they just go right to the grave. No. You got to take authority. And you know the word. God's been talking to you, giving you the word. You know what the word says. You know your authority.
Mm-hmm.
You got to take what? Over. Joseph can say, well, now, if y'all don't want to save it, well, let me know. Holler at me. No, ain't gonna be like that. You're going to bow down when I show up, and you're going to save that extra week that comes in here. You ain't going to spend the whole dollar. I'm going to be coming back checking.
All
right. As I come through. That's how you take authority. You got to take authority. So, there's men who's had this kind of ministry before. Daniel. I don't have time to read it, but let's, if you keep, can keep your thumb, jump into Mark 10:42. You got to exercise. You just can't have authority. You have to exercise authority.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
So, let's say Mark 10:42. Anybody feel like reading that? And I'm going to read through verse 45. If you
but Jesus called them to him and said unto them, you know
that they which are accounted to rule over the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and their great ones exercise authority upon them. Mm-hmm. But so shall it not be among you, but whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister, and whosoever of you will be the chiefest shall be the servant of all. Mm-hmm. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many.
That's right, praise God. So in verse 42, the key is that you know how they do it over in the Gentile world. Somebody is exercising authority. Somebody is the boss, and they're acting like the boss. In your life, somebody is the boss, and they act like it. It's either going to be you or the devil. You know, not only can you have authority, you got to deal with it. Hallelujah. I don't think Brother Beauty come home and say,
that get me in trouble.
Ah, yeah. Hey, what's my dinner? Where's my clean clothes? You know? I don't think Sister Deborah come home and say, when you cut the yard? She don't have to ask him that. Brother, no, you better have that yard what? Cut? I don't have to answer to Deborah. No? Call the attorney some iron. You think he send Deborah out to iron the tires?
No.
She said, you know, don't even bring that issue up to her. This is authority. You got, not only do you have that position, but you got to work it. That's what he's saying here. You know how they do it over there. They exercise authority. They throw their weight around. Okay. Praise God. And that's what Joseph was doing. Now we understand Joseph's background. He got sold into slavery. And that would be a bad deal if your brothers, many have brothers. I mean, blood brothers. Brothers got brothers. And if one of your brothers did you wrong, sold you into slavery, did you wrong, didn't have your back, you'll feel what? Bad. Hurt. Especially the experiences that Joseph is having. Do you think all of this, even now, makes him feel good about that experience? Like he's got over it? No. We can be saved and have all authority that God, like he has given to us, and our loved ones hurt us, and we'll still what? Feel it. I feel it. Still feel it. Paul says, but my greatest desire is that my brethren might be what? Saved. So he had all going on, all this going on. So here's what's going on. Life goes on. Joseph's a young man. Pretty Egyptian girls walking around. I've been in the pen. I wish I was there. I've been locked up. Got this Cadillac. Riding good, living good. We want to get saved and forget that we're worth it. Ain't that right, Brother Curtis? We don't see pretty girls. Same thing with the Holy Ghost, a little faith. Been in the pen for a long time. Pretty girl come. So we're dealing in reality. Man has a need. Man should not be what? Alone. That Adam, he should not be alone. Got all this authority, all this going on for him, but he should not be what? Alone. He needs a what? Helpmate. He needs a W-I-F-E. They don't teach that. Okay. Help me out, brother. All right, verse 45, somebody. What's it say there?
In Genesis?
Genesis 41, 45.
And Pharaoh called Joseph's name.
That's Zabnep. Mm-hmm. Pi-anet.
Okay. And he gave him to wife
Asenath,
the daughter of Potiphar, priest of On. And Joseph went out over all the land.
That's what I was just talking about. Joseph needed a wife, and Pharaoh knew it, so I'm going to give you one of my boys' kids. And it was a high priest, so a priest of Pharaoh, and he says, I'm going to give you one of his daughters. And a nice, here you go. Okay. Mixed marriage. I'm Hebrew, she's Egyptian, but I've been like the hook at it. Here we go. As a matter of fact, they threw me in here, so I'm, you know, hey, here we go. Okay. All right. I wish I wasn't in church, but anyway. All right, so here we go to...